Jim, I have to confess that, as usual, I usually come from a somewhat confused state, and yesterday we only got around to deciding what the talk would be around 7 o'clock at night. We sent you information ahead of time, and that was all wrong. So we were starting off initially talking about pragmatic imagination. We wanted to talk about, this is the chapter you might have read in our book.
No, it was public policy first. Then it was that.
Yeah.
This is the third.
And a few minutes before they were working on it.
Yeah, right. So I also have the title of being chief of confusion. But the idea was to think about the crisis of imagination that we face in public policy and kind of rethinking how to redesign public policy around the notion of this white water world that Anne's talking about. But after thinking about that more and giving some of the programs here, this whole sense of agency and tools for agency, we really wanted to kind of focus more on rather than the philosophic frameworks for some of this stuff. So we were really kind of hit by, and for some time now, with a fantastic quote from John Rendon. Now, many of you probably don't know John Rendon. It's probably okay, because he's very controversial. If you ever saw the movie Wag the Dog, that was actually built around him. So certain communities would get up and walk out, but nevertheless, he understands how to make things happen in a radically contingent world better than almost anybody. And Anne and I have had the great privilege of working with him. And there's a wonderful quote that we often use, and is that the world has just come together too quickly. We need a new tool set. And this is about the stepping toward a new tool set. So with that, let me turn that over to you.
Thanks. So I had, I'm not going to be speaking with a room mic, so I'll because then I would have to carry two big boxes around and have two microphones. So hopefully you can hear me, and if at any point you can't, just raise your hand. So I had the enormous privilege of meeting Don Norman for the first time in Banff last year. And so in a conference on systems, perspectives, and design, he presented probably what I consider to be one of the best characterizations and definitions of wicked problems ever. And this is something I study, so I know all of the definitions. And he just really hit it, hit the nail on the head. Then he said, which was wonderful, designers are very badly trained. He didn't say we're bad at it. He just said we're badly trained for these kinds of problems because we're trained as craftspeople, taught to draw, to build things, to produce, to manufacture, not necessarily the larger social aspects. So kind of this notion of maybe thinking systems, which is what we're going to talk about today. But then he initiated this wonderful meme around the conference, which comes from Charles Lindbergh's his complex problem, the economist out of Yale, complex problem-solving mechanism of muddling through. And if you know anything about muddling through, this was actually a real approach to public policy, which recognized that when dealing with complex socio-technical problems, one could not plan definitively, but instead you had to muddle through, which meant doing well the little things that come up to make progress. And he had a whole, so it was instead of decision trees, it was a different way of operating. And this is a tactical kind of heuristic approach, which we know well, with merit in kind of bottom-up humility and its desire for moving forward through action. And often small things done well do scale. We know that. But we'd like to suggest that we actually can do better than muddle through. And so what we decided last night to present was one of the chapters from our book, which is how do you begin to actually design ecologies of change as opposed to muddle through. And so in the book, the book is a new tool set. There are 9 tools in there and 3 meta tools. The meta tools are things that aggregate other tools in the book. And these are all coming from design. And the Change Triangle 3.0 was one of those meta tools. I think we all intuit what ecologies and ecosystems mean, but I am going to define it because we are really taking a lot of this. The book, the tool set, marries design as it's practiced within architecture, which is a kind of practice of practices, and complexity science. That's really what it's marrying, is a real understanding of how complex systems, especially complex emergent systems, operate And so ecosystems we can intuit, but ecologies, which is what this book is, one of the books is called Ecologies of Action, another Ecologies of Influence. This comes from how do you influence a system. Ecologies just really simply is the notion of those systems that have components inside that are interacting in a manner with each other that they cannot be pulled apart, and they're interacting with their context as well. So it's really a kind of simple definition. So we start the chapter with 41 minutes into, I don't know if you've, how many of you have seen Dead Poets Society. Robin Williams is John Keating. He's this charismatic English teacher in a boarding school, in a conservative private boys' school in the Vermonts in 1950s. He dramatically jumps on top of his desk, and he challenges his students to come up onto the desk and to see the world around them in a really very different way. He says in the movie, I climbed on the desk to remind myself that we must always look at things from different angles, and that the world looks different from different angles, which we all know if we do design and all that. So this is a moment of inspired teaching. Yes, that's fantastic. And it's a moment that mobilizes his students to take on the world differently, to change their perspectives. But what's really interesting is, so John Rend and I were having breakfast, this person who creates amazing change in the world. He actually was very responsible for dampening down the violence in Colombia. There was a whole campaign around No Más Sangre, where they got the cartels to basically stop fighting each other in the streets and killing innocent people. But there were many different ways that they actually created this change in the system. So John and I were having breakfast, and he said, but so what changed in this scene? Because this is his favorite scene. And he said, was it the perspectives or was it the room? And I said, well, it's the room, of course. The thing that we were both saying is that, yes, people's perspectives were changing from jumping on top of the table. But more importantly, the whole context for their existence had changed. He had created a space of permission in which they had permission to see differently, to then think differently, and then to operate differently. So this was very, very important to me, this scene, that the room had actually changed. So what we want to talk about, and what the change triangle 3.0 was about, it's more than reframing. We all know how absolutely effective reframing can be, but it's really about actually creating whole ecologies of change. So classical reframing, as we know, is the shifting from one scheme of interpretation, a view of the world on kind of based upon values and perspectives, beliefs, to another. But these scenes actually illustrate a more complex set of change dynamics, which we will call this ecologies of change. So while reframing, you might be able to shift people's perspectives, that doesn't mean you take on the whole system around them. And what happens in Dead Poets Society is that ultimately the carpe diem is the kind of, we'll talk about that in a minute, in the kind of meta-narrative he uses, that this new space that they were in meant that the boys, because they were all boys, found ways to think differently, operate differently, the Dead Poets Society. That forced change in their family structures, and it forced change within their culture as well. So a whole ecology, think species in an ecosystem, it began to affect the whole system around that, and that's because it wasn't just reframing, it was a series of different possibilities of imagining alternate futures and then acting on it. So and I will run through what the change triangle is, but in the movie, Carpe Diem, Lads, Seize the Day, is really the meta-narrative that he used, that he put into the system, and I'll talk about meta-narratives. What happened is the boys took that on differently. For them, Seize the Day was different. Some of them, their dispositions were such that they could not go against their parents. Others seized it robustly from the beginning. So each of them began to construct their own actions that constructed their own personal stories. They also started with their own personal stories, the ways that they related to their friends, the ways that they related to their family, the ways that they related to the community. So those are the notion of the micro-narratives. The little stories, the stories we live every day that we construct identity around, and actually all of our behavior is associated with those micro-narratives, which we recalibrate and all the time, and we recalibrate with others as well. poetry, and I'll talk about mechanisms, was one mechanism. It was a way that the boys would get together and they would share a hyperbolic or dramatic form of language that allowed them to construct more abstract relationships and therefore envision new ways of operating. And it's not just about sensitivity. All of us who love poetry understand it shows us alternate worlds, if you will. But the Dead Poets Society itself, which was their club, was another mechanism that they used to come together and scaffold each other as they went through really hard times. If you know, the story ends tragically with one boy killing himself because he just can't find the way, and there were other things going on. But this was the society that they built around each other. In this, when I showed you Robin Williams on the desk, there's also another scene where all the boys are on the desk, and if you remember in the movie, they went from being assimilating what Robin was telling them till the end, when the headmaster comes in, Keating has been fired, and Robin Williams comes in and gets his stuff, and he begins to leave the room, and one of the boys jumps on top of the desk and goes, "Captain, oh, my captain." All the other boys, little by little, do it. They had changed. They were up against authority. If you think about how a teenager reacted to authority in the 1950s, this was not typical at all, okay? So our book is all about change in complex contexts. And the interesting thing is that complex, as we know, since you're designers in this area, they're defined by both human ecologies, the way we relate to each other and our interchanges as humans, but also material ecologies. And this means that they are about people, our social systems, our ideas, our beliefs and culture, the material environment, and technology's interaction with all of these. So for us, as we built this book, making progress on complex problems and shaping change in complex context requires approaching it as an interchange to understand and work at the interchange between social, material, mental, and technical domains. All of them, not one, but all of them. And that's what this triangle, so the change triangle 3.0 is really about how do you look at it from a dynamic systems perspective with understanding all of those interrelationships. So to design an ecology of conditions for change that works on changing the system itself, which is what the change triangle is about, we have another meta-mechanism called systems of action, which is where you're not really working on the whole system because you don't have access to the whole system, meaning there's no leadership, no capacity to influence leadership at the top. And so the systems of action is when you actually do things inside the system acupuncturally. It's a more viral kind of meta-mechanism. This is a more where you can begin to work somewhat more holistically. So the first thing you do is you need to define the boundaries of the system because they determine what's inside the system and what's outside the system. It's that simple. The components and agents that interact with each other and in what domain and the extent of the context in which these components and agents interact. So boundaries can be defined by geography, mountains, rivers, and deserts that form territorial edges. They can be defined by institutional constructs, a business, a university. They can be a corporation or a university defines a kind of container. If I say I want to take on all higher ed in the country, that's one thing. If I say I want to work on the land grants, it's another thing. If I say specifically Ohio State, if I say I want to work on all education in the country, it's one thing. K-12 is another. The boundaries change, and all of the system, the context, and the components change. These boundaries can be defined by markets, by regions or entities that trade together, and they can be defined by political, economic, or cultural structures. We know as the geopolitical borders break down, we're actually getting systems that cross those borders. So you have to find the edges there. What is important is that boundaries determine the limits of the system. Understanding the boundaries of the system is critical for working on the system. Changing the boundaries, moving up or down a level, changes the problem. We were working on a project in Maine, K-12 education, and what was really very interesting is as we started to do this, we were working with a wonderful agency up there and some people that were distributed in very different parts of the system. Someone finally said, you know, why Maine is not one Maine, Maine is two Maines. And I said, what do you mean? I mean, I knew what they meant, but I needed them to define it. They said, well, there's the rich, the Boston's Maine, and then there's the other Maine. And I said, well, but okay, fine, that's interesting. Is that really true? So I started to do my research. I found there were seven Maines. There are seven Maines. Seven Maines with different culture. You've got the French-speaking farmers in the Northwest. And this had to do, we did a whole bunch of data studies to find, to try to figure out what they were. So this is the notion that even if you, once you understand the boundary K through 12 in Maine, there might be smaller systems inside of that system. I love this slide because we all know when we fly over the Midwest, this is what we see. The whole thing is one ecosystem which is part of the river valley. Well, it's not a valley, the river plateau. But what's interesting is that each of these are their own systems determined by what crops being planted, how much water they get, what is the farmer is like, all sorts of things. So these are actually called ecotopes in ecology theory. So this is phenomenal when you begin to, and this is going to be more appropriate in a bit, this notion that even within your boundaries you may have subsets. So you have to always be very, very careful of this. Okay, so the Change Triangle 3.0 is a design scaffold for change. It's not a framework. A framework gives form to something. If I put a frame in a building, the building looks like the frame. A scaffold is something you put into the system lightly to collect things onto it such that you can then take it out and it's moving and operating on its own. Okay? It's an ecology of actions and mechanisms. So I've already talked about from reframing to an entire ecology of change. You define boundaries first. What's interesting in this meta-mechanism, this is so much about the social aspects that you have got to understand how narratives work and how networks work, and that'll become apparent later. This book within our system of books has three chapters. One chapter is all about understanding narratives, and another one about networks, and then there's the mechanism itself. So the Change Triangle 3.0 happened rather, I'd like to say it was designed intentionally. It was actually rather serendipitous because it kind of came to the fore in Aspen, in an Aspen roundtable, as a complete misreading on my part of JSB's previous Change Triangle with Todd Richman. So the first one was a Change Triangle done by Huey Mintzberg out of the Sloan School in 2003, which was a triangle that says there's three different ways that businesses go through change. You can either have the dramatic, charismatic leader, creates a lot of drama from the top, disrupts the whole system, forces it to happen. If he actually stays in power, he might do something. And they had some really good, successful examples. Then there's the change that comes from the side. You hire a McKinsey. They give you a strategic plan. It's structural change, and it comes from the side. It's very organized, and, well, we know how that works. And then there's the kind of change from the bottom, which is organic change, which is people in the system who are beginning to have impact on the system. Really, really messy. Guys at the top do not like this kind of change whatsoever. And the best it can do is actually pressure. So the Arab Spring, it's exactly what it was, change coming up from the bottom. So that was Huey Mintzberg, three different kinds of change. Then Todd Richmond and JSB put together a second change triangle that had to do with USC, had to do with how digital would operate. I completely misread it, and so now we have Change Triangle 3.0, which is this one here. So the and you know, he was so nice, he didn't tell me that I got it completely wrong till about 2 years later. And then I went. So because this one is not about either or. It is not about one thing you would do. It is about how do you, over time, dealing with a complex context, assess, come to know, work in systemically. You know, if you go to work, anyone who tends a garden knows, okay, we don't make a strategic plan for a garden and we do this. But yeah, we do. We go buy our seeds. How much of it has to be done in action? But with really, really good foresight relative to that. So there are five components to the change triangle. The first one is vision. The role of vision in the change triangle 3.0 is the kind of beginning concept. And I'm going to actually bring up a case study in a minute and it'll become, I'll talk about it relative to Dead Poets Society, which is a very simple ecology for change. Then I'm going to look at Stan McChrystal, what he did at JSOC. And so this will become more obvious when I actually talk about some examples. So it really is the beginning concept and the overarching agenda. Its influence is threefold. It creates the coherence. Everything else is the vision is what you aim for because it creates coherence. So it motivates and initiates the action. It orients the unfolding design and the action around it. And it assists in communicating abstract directions. That's what it really does. In Dead Poets Society, Keating's vision was to empower each student to think for himself in an educational environment that was set up to mold students to be just like their parents. Wealthy students prescribed pathways in their lives. His vision was to give them intellectual and emotional independence and responsibility for their lives. That was his vision. Okay? The vision is transferred. So the vision kind of sits outside of the triangle, because if you think of a map, the north is always the thing on the side that is how do you orient everything by. So to actually do work, the vision has to be translated into a meta-narrative to be operational in it. So the vision's transferred into the system through the meta-narrative. The Keating's vision was made operational through the meta-narrative that he provided, which was, so it's not something, so the vision's not communicated directly. He didn't say, I want you all to go out and fight the system you were born into, and it's going to be really hard, and one of you might kill yourself. And that's that. He didn't do that, and that your parents and teachers will hate you, and all of that, because he knew that. Instead, he challenged them, carpe diem, seize the day, make your lives extraordinary. Right? That was the meta-narrative that he created. So he engages the students by appealing to their youth, their micro-narratives, to their imagination, their sense of adventure, and their desires to be unique. We all want to be unique when we're in that powerboat stage of our lives. He didn't explicitly propose change, but by embracing his challenge and following his lead, change would occur. So this is how a meta-narrative works. It demands engagement, it appeals to the emotions, it appeals to the intellect, it looks forward, and it's action-oriented. It has to be action-oriented. It demands that one take ownership of the message and act through it. In order to accomplish that, meta-narratives must be strategically ambiguous. This is really important. Strategic ambiguity means that diverse individuals can identify with the message or the challenge, and they're unified in this process. Strategic ambiguity creates unified diversity. This is really, really important. It's different than a branding slogan. Okay? It cannot be absolutely precise. It has to be open. And it's broad and textured. It has to be broad, and that's like really hard. It has to be strategically ambiguous, but it has to be textured enough that it creates emotions and you want to operate on it. It's personal, while it's also part of a greater movement towards change. Okay, so we did the vision, we did the meta-narrative. The micro-narrative, so the meta-narrative is usually something that you can supply at the top, right? The micro-narratives, we've already said, are the little stories, are the small stories constructed from our lived experiences. They're not strategically ambiguous. They're individually unique. They can construct, recalibrate, and evolve our identities. We assimilate events in our world. They can be dramatic or they can be little. And to assimilate them, to close the gap between what we know and what we don't know, we find a way to tell ourselves a story. I mean, we don't sit there and go, what's my story? This is what we do, and we begin to operate out of that. But they're textured and fine-grained. Patterns in micro-narratives, interestingly enough, reveal the true colors of a group of people because micro-narratives belong to the street. So I have different micro-narratives than you, but there are people that I share similar micro-narratives with. The patterns are there. And we operate as tribes through those micro-narratives. The fourth component are social networks. And this is really, really important. So if the meta-narrative comes from the top as the way that the vision is brought into the triangle, micro-narratives come from the bottom. Social networks are the things at the center of the triangle. They are what transfer everything. They are what bring the meta-narrative and create potentially resonance with the micro-narratives. So meta-narratives set change in motion by creating a shared story to work toward. Micro-narratives contribute to and draw from this shared story. There has to be resonance between the two of them. And mechanisms do the work, I'll talk about mechanisms in a minute, required for change, but it's the social networks that distribute these narratives and spread the work through the system. Social networks connect people, organizations, resources, and efforts. They provide the means and the medium of transmission for content that varies widely from the tangible goods and things like that to the elusive stories, information, knowledge, emotion, and behavior. It really is through the flow of these intangibles that we build identity, trust, power, and social capital of all sorts. These define who we are. In the change triangle 3.0, the network is at the center. It fills the triangle and connects all of the components together. So there are three ways we need to think about networks and the work they do for the triangle. First, you have to identify and understand the networks you have. And I was going to draw, but I'll just use my hands for the moment. If I look at, identifying and understanding, I mean, you have to understand their topology or their shape or their structure and the dynamics of the flow. I'm not going to go into this. This is network theory. But the notion that in Keating, it was a very simple set of relationships. Keating at the top and the seven boys directly down from that. So I'm going to say that that triangle, if we were to actually draw the network as one with seven outliers, I've got a pretty tall and skinny triangle. The triangle, the kind of the equal angled one I've drawn for you is really kind of a neutral one. If you have a flat triangle, it really means that all of the stuff at the bottom is very close to the top. Networks, we have to understand that they're not homogeneous. We have to understand their texture, their neighborhoods, their nodes and supernodes. Nodes, so it's not just, I mean, it can be elusive. You can ask, how did that happen? But if you actually do a network analysis of your organization or whatever is within the boundaries, you can begin to find where there might be supernodes. In other words, people that others all flock to, and that doesn't mean that they're leaders. So understanding the texture, the structure, and how things are flowing through your network has to be part of what you're doing. And then you can actually architect changes in the network. We're not going to talk about this, but we do in our book. There's lots of ways to actually change, to remove a supernode that's virally bad, to build new architectures, to begin to knit together people. And it's not about a new org chart. It's about how you begin to play with water coolers and words, you know, to use a kind of silly kind of alliteration. Fifthly are the mechanisms. Mechanisms are things that do work. It's that simple. They are the things that create the means through which an effect is produced or a purpose is accomplished. Mechanisms are often processes or techniques that operate at the tactical and operational level. In traditional education, a mechanism, something that does work, is a curriculum. That does work. It tells students how to flow through the system. If I take my curriculum, throw it out, and build something called a content ecology, which is what we're doing at PRGS, completely different, already you cannot operate the same way. It's a whole different structure. So mechanisms serve as catalysts that might start change. So you might have to have some mechanisms that get you started. They serve as lenses through which to ask questions in order to understand the system, meaning I could do a survey or I could do an observation, or I could do an ethnographic study that is specifically getting at understanding my networks. That's a mechanism. They can be ways to circulate messages, to move information stories around, as instruction sets, as guides, as scaffolding for momentum. And you can see there's lots of ways to use them. Enticements, all sorts of different things. Mechanisms can be things that are readily available or already in the system embryonically. Dead Poet Society, they were reading poetry. It was already there. But the mechanism of creating a club around it, of using it, of bringing it to the fore as not just, well, it's one subject within all of it, all of these are a way to kind of take something in the system and give it a different purpose, a different ability to work. They can also be things that one designs for a specific purpose at hand. And they can be simple to complex. And there'll be some examples of that. So I talked about the shape of the triangle. This was just a sketch I did when I was talking with John Rendon, the idea that you know, in very hierarchical societies, or even authoritarian, where one guy rules everything, you've got tall, skinny triangles. The fact that we were talking about the Arab Spring, you begin to get something where the street begins to have an impact and move closer to the top.
Six on site, check the survivors. Sitting in the SAR bird. I want ground forces to move and secure the perimeter around that crash site. Can you guide the convoy in there?
Roger that.
We'll move quick. Whole damn city be coming down on top.
Star 401 coming down and see if you can light up the crash site.
That's the bad guy. Okay, so what General said there, what Sam Shepard said there is we just lost the initiative. Let me just get myself back here. Okay. So I'm going to talk about Stan McChrystal and the transformation of JSOC. The interesting thing, Stan, when I first met him, I met a bunch of his SEALs first, and when I finally met Stan, he showed, and I'll show you the picture in a minute, the picture of the black, the real Black Hawk down in the city. The interesting thing is he actually likened it to the moment at which he understood that the world had changed in terms of warfare, and that it was a completely different situation. The general there, what Sam Shepard says there, you may not have heard well, he said, we just lost the initiative. What's really important about that clip is that they went in, this was the Mogadishu incident in 1993, it was considered a routine exercise with the overwhelming American forces and technology going in to extricate one bad guy and maybe hopefully get some others as well. The interesting thing is they found themselves not only surrounded by a different kind of fighter, but the guy who took an RPG and shot down the helicopter was un was inexplicable, because RPGs are meant to be mounted on the ground, they're exceedingly heavy, they're exceedingly cumbersome, and you shoot them at tanks, which are very slow-moving targets that don't move. And here's someone shooting down from their shoulder a helicopter and creating this kind of this whole different and kind of incredulous situation. And then the notion, so Sam Shepard says, we just lost the initiative, is also a kind of misconstruction or misunderstanding of what war had become. Initiative in military terms, having the initiative means you control the battleground. And this notion that we lost the initiative, that is even possible to keep the initiative and control the battleground in the war, the kind of insurgencies and in the wars that we're part of, is its own fallacy. That was 1993. So I'm going to actually take us through this. It's in not tremendous detail, but enough texture to get the idea of how Stan McChrystal, now in 2003, I believe he took over, actually transformed JSOC from this kind of event to being faster, more agile, and out ahead of an enemy that was changing itself daily, and how that kind of institutional change happened. So this is the photograph that Stan showed me. So what's interesting is from their creation in the 70s and 80s, special ops units were an impressive collection of talent. Special ops are the elite of the elite. To become a Navy SEAL, you're probably one of about 800 people. To be a Navy SEAL that becomes part of JSOC, you're one in 60 of probably those one in 800. This is the kind of what they created. Impressive collection of highly diverse specialized talent. The Marines are not the Rangers, are not the SOAR, which are the helicopter guys. What's interesting is that a chain of visionary leaders had forged them into the most effective force of its kind, and that had proven its value repeatedly in the first 20 years as a relatively small hostage rescue and counterterrorism force. But between 1993 and 2003, because of the Mogadishu incident, there was pretty significant resistance to using special ops forces to take them out for terrorism in Afghanistan and the whole region. In fact, any time, whether it was Clinton or another, who asked for a plan from his generals, they would bring him back these, like, six-month-long battle plans, highly strategic, to take on the terrorists. So Special Ops boss General Peter Schumacher, I love this phrase, recalled that it was like having this brand new Ferrari in the garage, and nobody wants to take it out and race it because you're afraid of denting it. This is what they had built. So in the wake of 9/11, Rumsfeld basically said, how could we have not seen 9/11? How come we weren't in there with special ops? And he commissioned a report, and they came back. And then that was the point at which he signed an order that empowered JSOC to hunt al-Qaeda in as many as 15 different countries. In that period, understand, it doubled in size from 1,800 to 4,000. With the leadership of McChrystal, who radically transformed JSOC to fight a new kind of war while engaged in operations in Iraq, in the battlefield itself. So he took over command October 6, 2003, and to lead an unprecedented campaign. And interesting, it wasn't just that the battleground was different, it was a wide geographic area. So it was with the most highly trained and equipped elite forces of the Navy, Army, Air Force, but in a time and place when even being the most elite forces with the greatest technology, highly trained and equipped, was just not enough to carry out successful, even a few successful counterterrorism missions. So the first thing he did, he went in, and like any good designer who doesn't know he's a designer, he says, what do I have? What's on the table? How do I assess the context? But even before he did that, or in order to do that, he realized he kind of intuited great leadership, really good instincts based upon experience, instincts being merely just covert cognition, but still cognition. And one of them was to secure approval for a single point of contact and command. So what was happening is that forget my notes. The point was, at that point, the commander of Central Command had generals reporting to him from all over, but they would also be reporting to McChrystal. So McChrystal needed the commander to agree to change the reporting change to a single point of contact so that not only would he have the responsibility, not only would he have the directives, he would have the responsibility, and at the same time, he would begin to be able to build the trust of that group. So they didn't have kind of competing bosses, if you will. The second thing was about understanding the units he would command and setting the stage for what would become a new kind of capacity of operations. So McChrystal originally had tremendous doubts about taking this over. He'd not been in JSOC for many, many years, and to be effective in this purist environment, he really needed to be seen as one of them. Not only had he not been out there, but he himself was from the Army Rangers and had never served in what were considered the most elite of the other special ops units, green, the Army's elite commander unit, and the blues, the Navy SEAL special mission units. So he knew that he'd have to build a deep understanding of these troops, so that the very first thing he did is he went to visit each of these different troops, and he began to understand what were the cultures and what were they working with. And he came away understanding that what he really had was not JSOC as a single entity. He had a tribe of tribes. And all of these tribes, basically, they had things that kept them together. They all joined because they believed in America. There was the whole cult of the brotherhood. There was the notion of high performance. All of the reasons they joined the special ops were the same, but when it came to the differences between them, these guys hated these guys, these thought they were stupid, and anyways, the tremendous competition and stories like teams, like baseball teams that they held in terms of how, and I've been with these different groups within a room, and they might as well be from different planets. The dispositions that bring them to each of them, from wanting to be a Marine versus a SEAL versus a helicopter, the kind of education you've had. So there is this tremendous fracturing within what was seen to be was needing to operate as one force. The third thing he did was amazing. He realized that they were in a very tough situation and that he needed them, even if they were going to have different dispositions and different ways they operated, they needed to all be after the same thing, and that same thing had to have a value structure behind it. So he brought his commanders together, he created this two-day conference, and he showed them the Battle of Algiers and then had a long conversation around it. This was an insurgency not different than what they were faced with. He wanted two things. He needed in this conference, he didn't tell them, here's what I think and you guys should think the same. He initiated and orchestrated a conversation where the room came to an understanding that, excuse my language, but they didn't know what the fuck was out there. And they had to understand that they had to listen, that this was an environment that you could not, and that the other things is that there had to be a morality that torture could not happen, that these were people and they had to understand that personal side of it. And then the fourth thing he did, really important, he decided to go out and assess the situation on the ground. He went to Baghdad. He got off of the transport from the totally jet-lagged and already was on a helicopter going to Baghdad. He found that the American-led coalition headquarters there was a mess. He said they looked like they'd just come off a plane, that no one knew what they were doing, and that instead of, you know, the general coming and just kind of showing him a map and saying, here's what we're doing, they basically said, well, we think headquarters has it under control, so you tell us what to do and we'll do it. In Mosul, he found Petraeus with a small team, isolated with only rare bits of intelligence from Baghdad. They were engaged in one-off missions with limited effect. They had one intel person there. And in Tikrit, he found the same. So he found this highly, and they weren't talking to each other at all. And the most glaring was that on his way back, the most glaring was the way that they handled raw intelligence. They had piles of it of stuff in the corridors, from USB drives to computers to cell phones, really valuable stuff. We look at movies now and we see how special ops deals with intelligence. That's because of what Stan did. At the same time, they weren't turning any of this into actionable intelligence. And what happened is he experienced this direct result of this lack of communication and intelligence when one of his own Black Hawk helicopters was shot down as he was traveling. Not his, but the other one. And what the people in Washington said to him was, oh, okay, this is just a sign of desperation. We got them on the run. And Stan said, no, he said this was game on. This was a different war. This was game on. This is a war for intelligence. This is not about tanks and attacks. This is about intelligence. So he went back to headquarters. He pulled his guys together, and instead of pulling out the maps, he pulled out a whiteboard, and he said, this is what we've got. This is what he found, that the forward teams were out there doing stuff with only one intel analyst. Then the rear headquarters had the capacity to do something with intelligence, not much intelligence, high capacity, lots of analysts, but limited interaction with the forward teams, that they had hit a bottleneck. Nothing was getting through. These guys had bags and hallways worth of intelligence, and no analysts. The analysts were in headquarters, unable to do anything. But actually, I actually redrew his triangle, because not only was it a choke point, these guys weren't talking to each other. There was absolutely no experience. So the growing insurgency in Iraq, after he'd done this, with new leadership. Okay, so what I want to talk about here is just the notion of when he took it on, they actually had intelligence about Saddam Hussein. One of the first things they were able to do was to capture Saddam Hussein, and they began to use some of the techniques that Stan would use later to begin to get more intel on the ground. But what had been happening is Saddam was nothing compared to al-Zarqawi, because what had happened after 9/11 is that if you know anything about insurgencies, they work kind of like businesses work, and that there's the charismatic leader at the middle of it. Then there's a second ring that's doing all the kind of work, and then there's the third guys out in the field. Is what they did is they did, al-Zarqawi did three things. Basically, he said, we're going to get rid of the middle ring. No middle ring, you guys out on the outer ring. This is when they turned into cells. You are on your own. The center is there for one reason only, and that is to provide the emotional, the meta-narrative, if you will, that emotional empowerment, maybe money, but probably not money. Instead, they were connecting through technology and media. Cell phones, they were adopting the technology, they were adopting the kind of connected world faster and before us, and they were using that to train each other, to teach each other. And Zarqawi was using it to behead people, to create a campaign of terror, to begin to create a campaign in which his own men would begin to engage in more cruel behavior at the same time. So not only were we not able to deal with the before, what Zarqawi was doing was even more difficult. So Stan basically said he recognized that this is what they were, and that they had to become this. They had to become that the enemy was decentralized, agile, adaptable, enabled by new communication technologies, and they had to become the same. So he said it would take a network to defeat a network. That's what he did within his first week. He didn't go to that. So that was him assessing the context. Then there's the creating the brief. I'm not going to do what's a brief, because I'm assuming we all understand what a brief is in this context. How do we begin to give texture to what you have to accomplish? So in Iraq, cutting-edge technology provided them this near-perfect situational awareness, this common operational picture. This was the first war in which they could see all their operations unfolding in real time, and they were attached to partner organizations in real time. But while this was wonderful to explain what had happened, it couldn't give them foresight. So they'd moved from data-poor but fairly predictable settings to data-rich but uncertain ones. So they had data, but they didn't know what to do with it. So, and unlike using satellite imagery to look at tank formations, intelligence about this new form of insurgency was both fleeting and highly perishable. So to create the brief, Stan basically, it was about learning from the enemy, to learn about speed and interdependence. It had rendered the environment incompatible with the vertical and the horizontal stratification that had maintained military order for centuries. The vertical chain of command, you want to do X, an operation tonight, once it goes through the layers of operations to tactics to strategy and comes back down, it's 3 weeks later. And they're not where they used to be. So this was impossible. The horizontal divisions only work if operating theaters are not inextricably linked. You don't have the SEAL out in the water and the Army guy on land and the helicopter guy you call when you need to move stuff. This was an environment in which they needed to remain extremely expert at what they did, but they needed to bring it all together and work together in real time, remembering that it's a tribe of tribes. So it was really very interesting. So Stan was saying we need to go from an hourglass, which was the basically the triangle upside down, to flatten fast. They had to have performance, speed, agility, interdependence, a new organizational architecture, and new practices were needed. And so the first thing he says, well, do we have this capacity here? Another thing to do is you need to become X. Is it somewhere? Is it on the edge? Where is it in the organization? And he began he looked at the Navy SEALs, because the Navy SEAL had become shorthand not only for superhuman performance, this combination of strength, bravery, and skill, but the remarkable quality of SEAL teams has been around forever. It has less to do with individual talent. They are high performance with instinctive cooperative adaptability because they operate as teams with a shared consciousness. So Coleman Ruiz, really good friend of mine, 13-year veteran of the SEALs, he actually is the officer in charge of BUDS. This is where it all starts. So he says the physical challenges are tough, but they are in fact fairly achievable. The notion that physical prowess is the primary determinant of success or failure is false. In the absence of debilitating medical conditions, which I will claim since I could not be a SEAL, so I must have debilitating medical conditions, if a person wants to do it, they can. The purpose of BUDS is not to produce super soldiers, but to build super teams. And there's a way they do it. They go through three different processes. But it's things like the very first thing, you're in a boat, an inflatable, and they start by creating teams of eight, hoping at the end that they will get four, a fire team of four out of it. They stay together for 6 months. You get in an inflatable boat, and you know immediately, unless you're working as a single body, that boat goes over. And they do this all the way to one of the things they do is you have to be with a buddy in dark water, underwater at night, go from point A to B, and all you have is a compass, and you have to remember the map of how to have gotten. Oh, a compass and a watch. And there's two of you. And you're on one tank of oxygen. And you have to get from A to B. The notion of, and so you can't talk under there. The ability to, so it's going from individual performance to team performance, bonds of trust, a common purpose in a shifting environment. This notion of developing emergent intelligence that can thrive in the absence of a plan. And they call this shared consciousness. It's what they try to do. So the point was, how do you now go from a tribe of tribes, so this was the brief, to a team of teams, scaling all of this so that you go, basically, you create shared consciousness across all of JSOC. That was the idea. So that was the concept. To move from an hourglass to flat and fast, and now it'll go a little faster. I'm going to talk about, so the main idea, the main concept was this. People cooperate only if they can see the interdependent reality of their environment. So trainees learn to work together in Bud Surf because they can see that one individual's failure will result in the failure of the entire team. And if that happens, the whole group will suffer. They know what the job is to keep the boat afloat. It's very clear. There's no mystery there. And they know what their role in that job is. So how do you scale that? So for Stan, it was how do you see the system? How do you, as an individual, see the entire system, and how do you know your role in it? So he knew he had to dismantle the deeply rooted system of secrecy, clearances, and interforce rivalries. He had to establish in his place an environment of radical transparency so that every man and woman in the command understood the emergent complexity of the problem. So this had to be in real time. This couldn't be, okay, twice a month even, this or once a year. Understood his or her role within this system that represented all of their undertakings, the whole mission, and was intimately familiar with every branch and was personally invested in the outcome. See the system, see the battleground, understand what's going on, and know what your role is in it. And even if you disagree, at least you understand what's going on. So we needed to fuse generalized awareness with specialized expertise. The notion, though, the idea that diverse specialized abilities are essential for what they were doing. They had to maintain that, which means they had to maintain the cultures of the tribes, but they had to bring them together into a shared. So there were a series of mechanisms for change that Stan did. So he assessed, first of all, he was really smart at assessing the context. He knew there were some things he had to do at the beginning, and then he set to work. And these mechanisms created the change, and they fall into a series of buckets. I'm gonna talk about eight of them quickly and then show you how all of this maps into the triangle. So they either fall into a new physical space, new practices, integrating intel and operations, cross-cutting cultures and building trust, pushing decision-making down to operations level, and a new leadership model. So first, he created a new physical space. He moved the headquarters to Balad in an old bunker, and he actually moved his living into that same bunker. And he created a physical space for communication and flow of ideas. This was the Joint Operations Command. And what he did is, it was a wall of screens. He still works this way with live updates at the front. Personnel was strategically placed depending upon where they were. Those that needed the information and were operating in the most advanced positions were up front. The people who need more focused attention were in the back. He brought in intelligent analysts, operations officers, military liaisons, intelligence surveillance and reconnaissance operators, air power, lawyers, and medical staff. He brought them all into the same space, and he gave them a position depending upon what would be best for what they do. And the entire area was designated top secret. The entire area. So DOD lawyers were seeing what the operations officers were seeing. Completely. And around that, he created, he created another model of that inside of it. When he started, I think there were 60 people in the Joint Operations Command. By the time they were done, they had about 200, 300 people in there. But he also had a smaller replica of it, the strategic, situational awareness room, where he worked alongside his key staff, the directors, the people at the top. There were also senior representatives from multiple interagency organizations, from the CIA, from the local intelligence groups. Those seats were empty at first. So while the Joint Operations Command, the really big one, was focused on Iraq, the Situational Awareness Room was global. Then they created a bunch of new practices. These aren't the critical one. The really critical one is this, which I'll talk about. But they started by saying, if the whole room is designated as top secret, we're going to add people to the CC line of emails. The way to deal with unintended consequences is anyone you think that might be part of an unintended consequence, you put them in the CC. So they can come back at you and say, but you didn't know this, you idiot, right? And they took almost all the phone calls on speaker phones. This was not easy at first. I'm not going to say it wasn't. But the most critical, one of the most effective mechanisms for transforming the Task Force 714 into a flattened operational network was this aggressive and early implementation of operations and intelligence video conferences. They were daily, 6 days a week, never canceled, 90-minute to 2-hour updates created to tie together geographically distributed command. It was 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time and 4 o'clock in Iraq. It was about actionable information that cross-cut rank. It was eventually a worldwide forum of thousands. It created a culture of transparency and inclusion. They were dealing with granular tactics alongside strategy, intelligence alongside operations, resourcing alongside values. And perhaps the most important outcome was the seamless blending of operations and intelligence. What the ops call themselves silverbacks. They're like the silverbacks, and then there's the geeks. It was a powerful tool for leading a dispersed force, invaluable lessons of leadership and action. The way it worked, Stan went online. Anyone who felt they wanted at any time, from Washington to the most remote regions of Iraq or Afghanistan or the border, anyone with vested interest could sit in. But it was clear that there were certain topics of importance that day, so certain people were going to have to give information. It did not follow command. Stan would say, so-and-so, who might be really just not even a task force command level. He might have been an operations person 3 up from the bottom. Knowing something, had the on-the-ground information, and Stan would say, what do you know? This is what we know. So-and-so who might be related, Stan would say, what do you know? Someone else might come on and just simply say, I can add to this. Stan would say, fine, what do you need? What do you need for success? And they would say, and what was fascinating is that everyone would listen in. Your boss would hear stand making decisions, other people involved in those decisions. You are bringing on-the-ground information into this forum, and everybody was listening. Imagine being in Washington thinking you know you have the answer, and you're hearing the guy who's really on the ground who just lost three of his buddies saying, this is why we lost three buddies. Right? Imagine that kind of in real time, everyday information you begin to get. Even if you don't agree, you know why the decision was made. You can't leave the room and have your own opinion without everybody saying, yeah, but you heard what was going on. This ability to say, and it was always, what do you need for success? So not only was it, oh, I get to talk to Stan and my boss is listening, it's like, oh, shit, now I have to be successful. If I tell him I need this and he gives me this, I better be able to do it. Very, very powerful tool. They never, ever canceled them. And at the beginning, it was horrible because, as Stan said, when you've got Washington listening and everybody's got an opinion. So he'd get all these opinions about what he should be doing. But over time, and the radical transparency was hard for the middle management, incredibly hard. But over time, they saw the impact. They went from 10 missions a month, not often successful, to 300 successful missions a month. A faster and you know, faster, smarter enemy, and with technology going.
And most of them.
What?
And most of them worked.
And most all of them worked, yeah. And they would get intel one from one raid, and they'd be off to another one. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. So critically, the O&I fostered decentralized initiative and free thinking while maintaining control of the organization, and keeping energy at the lowest levels directed toward a common strategy. You could complain, but you knew why the decision was there. This was meant to liberate subordinates and remove unnecessary hesitation. This is from Coleman. When I told a major, for example, that he did not have to ask permission to do something, I simultaneously broadcast that directed to all of the other majors. And everyone left the O&I confident that they saw the organization's intent, what was going on, and their position within it. After the main O&I VT, then at the task force level, the next level down, they would do it again, and they get more granular about missions. But one of the most brilliant things was this notion of integrating intelligence and operations. So this is a third mechanism. He brought intelligent analysts and agencies into the field of operations for day one. The guys from Washington, CIA, he began to see that in addition to rewiring their own force, that they had to make their relationships with the intelligence agencies deeper and broader. We could not be a special operations force only, or even a military only, we needed to form a true joint interagency task force. The fourth mechanism, so this idea of bringing into the tent the intel people to the JOC from everywhere, was the fourth mechanism was to find a way to create new processes for agile turnaround of intelligence that they captured in their raids. So they first created a JSOC. So you could say there's a bunch of mechanisms here. They created the OpsNet, which was their own intranet. They partnered with this highly skilled but obscure, underutilized agency in DC, the National Media Exploitation Center. They were able to turn things around in 24 hours. They increased the bandwidth that they had, just the technical. And tech experts were asked to get creative. They started learning to hack into cell phones, inventing software. Innovation was permeating. This is probably one of the most amazing things, Mechanism 5, this idea that they blended intelligence and operations through what they called this pattern of life analysis. This creating an unblinking eye. Drones out there, instead of sending out drones or using satellites when they thought they had something, the special ops would come back and they'd say, we should probably watch this. And they would barter for their 24 hours, constant surveillance. So they were looking, like in all complex systems, for patterns of change. This is how they got Zakari. This is actually how they got Saddam. These small patterns of change. This is how they would be able to have one operation in a night, find something there, or the intel guy back in headquarters would say, you know what, you went in and a car went out the back, and we're going to follow that. So then they would begin to radio to another team and say, go follow the car out back. And they would do 10 operations a night. But the amazing thing is that they worked shoulder to shoulder. So the analysts and the operatives would come together, they would sit together, and the analyst would say, this is what I'm doing. And the operative would say, I think this is what that means, and could you send that over there? The operatives would go to bed. The analysts would stay up all night. I'm sorry, the operatives worked at night, so they would go to bed in the morning. The analysts would stay up all day. When the operatives woke up, the analysts might say, you know what, we saw something last night. You should change your missions. This ability to work so, the geeks and the silverbacks was impressive. In fact, on one of the O&I VTCs, one of the operatives was actually beginning to create insight around information that someone else had in a way that they pulled him into the Intel group. He was the youngest Intel officer at 32 that they ever brought into the tent. So even a silverback, so people moved into different positions. Blend, and it blended the cultures. This distrust, oh, those operatives are just, you know, these stupid guys out there with guns, or the Intel guys, they don't know our life. They were able, they developed these incredible symbiotic teams. Okay, yeah, well, this is critical. There's two more, okay. The other critical thing is that typically there is a cycle of operations. You find a target, you fix it, make sure it doesn't stay, you finish it, you exploit and analyze. Typically special ops would work here. They began to ask special ops to work there. Stanley basically pushed decision making down to the level of the operatives. They had the right. They were actually asked to be entrepreneurial in battle. That's what created the actual connective tissue. So that's. And then the other one was that they began to horse trade for resources based on priority in all of the different O&I. So can you imagine in your organization actually horse trading? Actually someone saying, you know what, use my helicopters, use my printer, because you need it more than me, your operation, and I know that I will get the same later. They cross-cut culture and built trust through a series of other mechanisms. And I will now map the triangle. Okay, so there's our triangle. I'll read this because it's hard to see. So the vision was to regain the initiative in a new kind of war. That was the vision. The meta-narrative was it takes a network to find a network, which a little bit more textured, transforming JSOC to be flat and fast, displaying unconventional adaptability by working in a constant cycle of operations and intelligence. Every mission is a fight for intelligence, not just a win against the enemy. Micro-narratives we've already talked about. There were a whole series of micro-narratives, of unit-level narratives that were very asynchronous. They were both literally and figuratively individual-specific stories. So these guys had different stories. How could Stan use their stories and his narrative and put it together? I won't talk, we know that. And I just went through the mechanisms of transformation, the bringing intelligence, new processes for all of the ones I just went through. So these are the things that, if you're beginning to diagram it, are added to the system to make use of those, distribute that, and understanding the way that the networks begin to work. But Stan re-architected it so that instead of a tree diagram, the operations level, not the whole thing, the operations level became a network of networks. So the whole thing didn't transform, but at the operations level, you had Intel guys with SEALs and those. So the results were that he did create this scale, shared consciousness as a team of team. They went from 10 missions a month to 300 missions a month with greater precision and intelligence yield against a fatter, smart enemy. So not only did Stan take the Ferrari out of the garage, he really transformed it into a fleet of Ducatis. That's it. Sorry. Okay. Sorry for the length.
A couple of things that really hit me, being on the side of watching so much of this and knowing all her friends doing this stuff. By the way, the SEALs training site is just down the road.
Coronado.
The Butch group. So, and if you ever have a chance, the kind of way they do training is almost unimaginable to most of us. And yet the consequences of shared consciousness coming out of that is amazing. A couple of things that really hit me, and we all understand the problems of the hierarchy. The real question is, how is it possible to transform ourselves into a network such that a network can fight a network? And it's easy to say that poetically. It's very interesting to see the hardest organization in some sense in the world is to transform such a hierarchical organization, to see the mechanisms actually used to be able to pull that off. Really gets us to kind of step back and think through the worlds we're walking in, what other mechanisms that might be at work here. And you know, speaking more personally, even coming from the early stuff at Park as well, some stuff with the group, but what is when Stan Stan created this group in the desert to have the analysts and the shooters or the operators
work,
you know, shoulder to shoulder, literally shoulder to shoulder. What's so amazing is you really watch how these special ops work. They couple basically a geek with a manager, and then we know. And only now we're beginning to understand with the kind of technologies in return, what happens if you can actually have such a deep coupling. Just like somebody who completely understands how to pull the information instantly for you out of the networks with someone who's capable of creating an action. And that close coupling turns out to be just simply overwhelming. And we're now walking into a world where that kind of coupling, we're now seeing more and more. It's so different from what we used to kind of pass the request up through SQL mechanisms or whatever and get it back a day or two or a week later, in Stan's case, 3 weeks later. That sense of real-time connection. And some of you know, we can obviously build, you know, world-class chess machines, et cetera, et cetera. Today, there's something called freestyle chess, which takes an average chess player, 1600, with an average computer, put the two together, where basically the geek, quote unquote, really understands how to work very carefully with the person with tremendous imagination. If you can put somebody with deep imagination with somebody who understands how to use technology to craft the logic and find fallacies of it, you put those two together today, nothing beats them. They beat the world champions chess, the world's best chess machines, and so on and so forth. So there's something very interesting of what does it mean to figure out what are the mechanisms that actually enable this new working style together, which is now so possible, which just, you know, a few years ago was unthinkable. But let's get questions.